BBOR, Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. And yes, today we are rediscussing the case of Maura Murray, the disappearance from 2004 that has a lot of people just asking the question, what on earth happened? Maura Murray went missing on February 9th of that year after crashing her car into a snowbank in Haverhill, New Hampshire. Because we're spending a lot of time indoors these days, I started listening to the podcast 107 degrees. Every day I would just listen to the next episode, and now I have made it to the end of the series, as even including the bonus episode. What do the hosts, Ethan and Aaron, have to say about this one? And what can we learn about the disappearance of Maura Murray, one of the most perplexing missing persons cases in the world, really? What I would say about this one is that Maura Murray crashed her car into a snowbank at about 7:30 p.m., disappeared into the night, never seen or heard from again. No conclusive sightings. Some people have brought up some possibilities, but it's very important to admit, no conclusive sightings, correspondences, or contact with the world in any way. So what do we have to say about all this? I would say that the first thing that I noted from this series is they're very much focused on Maura's reputation. They're talking about some other media outlets, particularly an individual who wrote a book called True Crime Addict. We don't say his name on this channel because he's kind of a jerk, but they're trying to say that this series, or that people like him are saying that Maura was this out of control, dysfunctional, borderline sociopathic, deviant, who had just had all of these problems going on. She was on the verge of a mental breakdown. She was on the verge of a psychotic break. And there could also be something mysterious and like some clever scheme involved to take Maura Murray to a different place. And the other more balanced series that people have just been discussing in comment sections and on forums, as well as on other parts of YouTube, about what happened to Maura is simply quite to the contrary of those bold claims. It's just that Maura crashed her car, she got into somebody else's car, and then she was met with some form of foul play, which ultimately led to her death. Now, 107 Degrees really wanted to reduce the scandalous aspects. They really wanted to show that people are sensationalizing this story. They really wanted to show that people are blowing this case out of proportion, perhaps for fame and profit. It's very possible. Not much of a mind reader, but it definitely appears that some people, like that True Crime Addict guy, would be doing that. Some of the things that they want to say is, I'd say 107 Degrees really zoned in on the crash site. Maura crashed her Black Saturn, so they would say, and that there was a rag found in the tailpipe, and underneath Maura's car was a Diet Coke bottle that had some sort of red liquid in it that had been poured out into the snow. But the officer that examined the bottle did not drink alcohol and admitted that they were not familiar with what alcohol smelled like. That was a contribution that 107 Degrees, the hosts Ethan and Aaron, shared with us. So we aren't really sure what was in the bottle, and it's very difficult to determine the contents of a bottle if they've been poured into the snow. But the very famous line is that there was some red liquid there. Another thing to note is there was a crack on Maura's windshield, the windshield of the Black Saturn, and it could have possibly come from Maura's head, or it could have come from an object in the car. I would say that I really do not believe that Maura Murray would have hit her head on the windshield. I mean, it's possible, but I think there would be a little bit more forensic evidence. Some fiber of some kind would probably still have stayed in the cracked glass. But that's just my two cents on the subject. I do not necessarily know 100%. As for the rag and the tailpipe and the bottle, these are the two things that I felt 107 Degrees was just zoning in on. In the past, I had always thought that there was wine in that bottle and that the rag and the tailpipe was something that Maura had put there to distract people from a possible case of drunk driving. And even somebody agreed with that and left that exact comment on one of the 107 Degrees uploads. They're saying, Maura put that rag in the tailpipe because she did not want a breathalyzer. That's almost exactly what they were talking about. Because they're like, she wanted to put some distance in between herself and the crash site. Because if she had been drinking, she wouldn't want a police officer to arrive, and then she would be charged with drunk driving. That's why there was liquid poured into the snow, and that's why there was the Diet Coke bottle with the bizarre odor coming from it. The reason what that 107 degrees really wants us to say that they don't necessarily know if she was drunk driving or not was because there was a box of wine in the back seat of the Saturn that was unopened. And if it had been unopened, well, where'd she get the wine from? I mean, there were no other bottles of wine. There were no other bottles of alcohol that had any red alcohol of any kind. They were just like, there is no evidence to say that Maura was driving drunk. That is one of their biggest claims. They mentioned it many times throughout the entire podcast series. So what do we make of that? Now, I went to college, and when I went to college classes, I did not learn anything, sad to say. But the things that you do learn in college is, say, for example, you're at a party or something, and there's just a little bit of alcohol left over. People often pour those into bottles that do not have alcoholic labels on them because they are easier to transport. And 107 degrees even mentioned that it is illegal to transport more than 3 liters of alcohol across state lines in New Hampshire without a liquor license. Maura was, of course, from Massachusetts, a student at UMass at Amherst in the nursing program. I mean, people do this all the time. They pour alcohol into a bottle that doesn't have an alcoholic label on it, say a Diet Coke bottle. We used to use them in juice bottles. I swear we poured it into a juice box once. People do this all the time. So it's highly possible that even if the box of wine in the backseat wasn't open, Maura could have just had some alcohol of some sort in a Diet Coke bottle from a previous party that she had obtained previously. That's just what we can say. I don't necessarily know. And like I said, if the contents have been poured into the snow and that has probably been disintegrated, the bottle has probably been incinerated. So that, not disintegrated, incinerated was what I meant to say. It's very unlikely that we'll ever get a definitive answer. Now, what would be the alternative to Maura Murray drunk driving, putting a rag in a tailpipe and trying to get away? That's one theory. And even, I mean, the guys Lance and Tim were coming down that pathway, although they really left a big question mark. Lance and Tim from Missing Maura Murray, that is. They left a question mark about the rag and the tailpipe. Their response was, Fred Murray, Maura Murray's father, had offered the information to the media that he was the one who told Maura to put the rag in the tailpipe to keep the engine in her car from smoking. And people were just like, wait a second. If he put the rag in the tailpipe, the car wouldn't start. If there had been a rag in the tailpipe, could that have caused the accident? And this rag was sticking out because once it got to the garage, the Black Saturn, that is, Fred Maury removed the rag with his bare hands and started up the car. I had never connected the dots when I heard that on Missing Maura Murray until I heard it on 107 Degrees. Fred Murray removed the rag from the tailpipe and then started the car? Wait a second. I thought you couldn't drive the car. I thought that the car had lost its ability to start, and that's why Maura got out of it in the first place. What on earth was going on? What 107 Degrees really tried to say is that they believe that Maura went off the road somehow, some way, somehow. She might have even been involved with a previous accident earlier in the day, and there are a few reasons for that that we'll say in a minute. But she would have gone off the road. And with Maura's particular Saturn, this discussion was a little bit over my head because they're talking about lots of technical things and the very particular functionality and the gizmos of that Saturn. But what I believe they were saying is, with that Saturn, if she were to turn the key and pull it out and then put it back into the ignition, she would have been able to start the car. What Maura had to have been doing was, after the crash, she had a lapse in judgment. She was just turning the key back and forth and thought the car wouldn't start. If she had removed it from the ignition, put it back in, then it would have started normally. So that's another big thing to note right there. I mean, another big possibility. After Maura's crash, she thinks her car is inoperable. An individual named Butch Atwood came by in a school bus coming off of his evening shift, and he looks and sees Maura by the car. He asked her if she wanted him to make any calls. She said she didn't need it because she had already called AAA. And what 107 Degrees wanted to talk about was they wanted to bring up the possibility that Maura was not being mischievous. She wasn't some type of compulsive pathological liar. She simply said her first instinct was, I want to solve this problem myself, so the host Aaron theorized. Then she decided that she wanted to walk down the road. But a big contribution from Butch Atwood, and 107 Degrees was really stating this as a possible fact, when they were just saying that if what he says is true, there was no cell service in that area of New Hampshire at the time, 2004. That would mean that if Maura thought her car was inoperable, that she would have walked down the road because she was trying to get to a phone. Why would she refuse the first person that offered her help? She wanted to solve the problem herself. Then she walks about maybe 80 meters, 100 meters. She walks a short distance from the car and then is able to decide that, okay, maybe this is actually a really far distance to the nearest phone. Somebody comes by and offers her a ride. And then she accepts that one. She turns down the first person, then accepts the second person. I mean, as I said, though, when I was 21 years old, I would have had probably some very similar judgment. I mean, like, I would have done things rather similarly. Granted, Maura and I would be different people. I mean, that's not the craziest thing in the world. That is not a far-out theory that they put forward. That Maura thought her car was inoperable. She got out. Then she tried to get to perhaps the service station, perhaps some area with a payphone. Somebody offered to give her a ride. Not Butch Atwood, but a different person. And that person did something that caused Maura's death. Some incident of foul play took place. And the only other thing to say about the rag and the tailpipe is, when they say that Fred offered that information to the media, what I believe 107 Degrees was trying to say is, he did indeed tell Maura that she should put the rag in the tailpipe to keep the engine from smoking, but that was after the car was stationary, and that most likely Maura went back to the emergency kit of the car, took the rag out of that kit, and put it into the tailpipe, because she didn't want smoke to pour out of the car. It would attract people. They would think that possibly there was a fire. In short, it would get other people to start looking at the car and it would draw attention to it. And on Jason Hebert's YouTube channel, he even brought up the possibility just that Maura knew she was coming back. The car was locked. There's a box of wine in the back seat. And when you actually look at Maura's steps prior to Route 112, she had been making calls to places in the White Mountains, even to Stowe, Vermont, as far as that. Her father believes that she was driving to Bartlett, a town she was very familiar with. But 107 Degrees talked about how she may have been trying to go stay in North Conway, New Hampshire, or possibly Conway, New Hampshire. They would have had more places for her to stay. So this is somebody who was just thinking about going to the mountains for a week. And when we did an upload about Maura Murray in 2018, we were discussing one of the documentaries that brought up the point that a friend of Maura's had told this particular documentary that Maura was known to do things like this. She was the kind of person that would skip school, get on the train, and just go to the city. She had somewhat of an impulsive and risk-taking personality. And things like this, just telling her professors that she had a family emergency, was not out of the question. Yes, and that is one of the things we haven't talked about recently. Maura told people that she had a family emergency. In reality, no such emergency existed. It's highly possible Maura just fabricated that because she was having some rough times, so she wanted to go to the mountains for a week, go to a familiar place, maybe Bartlett, maybe North Conway. I mean, this is all theoretical. We don't have that definitive piece of evidence to say this is exactly what happened to Maura. On 107 Degrees, if you haven't heard that podcast and you just want to, you're like, I don't want to listen to like 20 hours or something. One of the segments that they did is actually a two-part series with an individual named Guy Parody. If you listen to anything that they have done, I would highly recommend listening to the Guy Parody interviews, because not only is he somebody who is an investigator, ex-military, but he's also an accident reconstructionist. And what they talked about is, if Maura's car had hit a tree, it would have looked like this. If it had hit the snowbank, it would have looked like that. And somebody even brought up that possibility in a recent Maura Murray upload that I did, when they were saying, now, wait a second. Looking at the damage to her black Saturn, it doesn't look like it hit a snowbank. And Guy Parody says with certainty, oh, so he believes that is, that Maura's car had to have collided with the back bumper of either a truck or a van or a large SUV. It's possible that there was another accident that took place en route to New Hampshire. I mean, we don't necessarily know about that, and Mora is not available to ask, but the point is, they're saying that it's highly likely that something happened to Mora's car prior to Route 112, and that could have altered its functionality. Fred Murray also wants to remind us that Mora's car was only running on three cylinders, let alone that the engine was smoking. If she had been told to put the rag in the tailpipe so that smoke wouldn't pour out of it. But I would also like to always remind us that it is not unheard of for people to have a rag up the tailpipe and start the car. I mean, that is one of those old-fashioned methods to start rust bucket cars. So one person was writing on a forum. But the big thing is, though, once the car was moved to a garage, Fred Murray arrived. They told him the car probably won't start with the rag in the tailpipe. He removed it with his bare hands, and then he started up the car. So some of the people that are involved with this as suspects are an individual named Rick Forsier. Guy Parody says that Rick Forsier, a neighbor of the Atwoods, the bus driver who last saw Mora Murray, is a prime suspect in his book. Rick Forsier also put out a very weird music video called Stalker or something like that, the stalking song. It was not very good. Other people look toward an individual named Bruce McKay, who was a police officer who just had some big discrepancies in his time logs, and they aren't necessarily sure where he was when Mora Murray went missing. Bruce McKay is now deceased after being shot after pepper spraying somebody, so the official narrative would have us would lead us to believe. And also, people look toward an individual named Cecil Smith. Now, you just have to hear this. Like, I do not believe that this theory is true, but one of the craziest theories that I ever heard about the Mora Murray case was the first officer to find Mora Murray's car, Cecil Smith, could have attacked Mora, raped her in the snow, and then thrown her body into the trunk of his car. I even did an upload on that in 2018 talking about that, because just about how ridiculous I thought that was. And I just thought, what are people thinking? They're just kind of mishmashing a bunch of craziness all together. How could you even think that was true? But in reality, a lot of people do think that the officer Cecil Smith could have known something about what happened to Mora, and then perhaps the police department used their administrative power to cover that up. I think it's rather interesting that Butch Atwood's wife did not know that Cecil Smith and Butch Atwood were friends. They were apparently drinking buddies, but during her interview with Jason Hebert, she says that she was completely unaware of that. There could be something going on there, or perhaps that could just be absolutely nothing. And perhaps in 15 years, she forgot about Cecil Smith, or just Butch Atwood didn't really know him that well. Butch Atwood is also deceased. I would still like to be optimistic about this. When we talk about true crime cases, I want to be very clear. I'm not really putting out my own theories anymore. I used to do that on this channel. We're mostly discussing the theories that were put out by Ethan and Aaron on 107 Degrees. And I definitely say it's a very plausible theory that Mora got into this wreck. She wasn't able to start the car. If I understand what they said correctly, it's like that very technical, and when you're listening to a podcast and a running monologue, but like, she wasn't able to start the car, so she got out, put the rag in the tailpipe, maybe Mora poured something out of a bottle, maybe not, who knows, not too relevant. What's much more important is what happened to Mora. Then she began to walk down the road, and then she got into somebody's car. And then, ultimately, Mora could have met with some foul play. It's highly possible, but we do not yet have certainty. Other people believe that perhaps she got into the car of a police officer and that officer did something to her. Not as extreme as the events that we just previously laid out, but it is something that people do discuss. Cecil Smith or Bruce McKay might know something, and Bruce McKay is also deceased. I mean, as you see, the years go by, a lot of people are no longer with us. But the big thing that I would like to say is one day I hope we get a definitive answer and we can say, case closed on the Mora Murray case. This is what happened. The family will get closure. The mystery will get solved. I'm not one of those people who's like, the chase is more fun than the catch. We all want answers to this. And that's the way that I hope we can approach this. But I would just like to leave you with the last question. What do you believe happened to Mora? And what do you think about any of the claims made on 107 Degrees and what we talked about here? Until next time.